Get me out of this mess. Gonna fly me so high. I can go at top speed. At least I can try. At least I can try. It's all been too much.
This is Lori Smith on Spreaker, and glad to be here. This is One Child Abuse Survivor to Another. That's what I've titled this show. Haven't been on for a while, and hopefully it's streaming properly. I've been trying to do a broadcast for about an hour now, and just had trouble with the sound and trouble with the mics, and so I'm not sure. Hopefully I'm streaming, but if not, you know, that's all right. Well, let's do another show. So, yeah, this is a show really in tribute for April Child Abuse Awareness Month. I haven't done a show all month, and usually I do speak out, do some internet radio during the month of April just for the National Child Abuse Awareness Day, you know, for mainly in the States, but elsewhere in the world too. And thanks for being here. I appreciate everybody's caught my shows and tuned in. You know, I care very much about this, and that's why I speak publicly about child abuse prevention and my own story. And you know, there's so many people out there who are struggling and suffering, and I know because I was one of them. And, it, you know, people would say, well, does it still affect you today? And it does. You know, I mean, it's, I don't think it's ever really ever going to completely be, you know, there'll be a day where there's never a thought that I wasn't damaged in some way from being abused as a child, you know, because something always ends up coming up. And, in life, you know, things happen, right? And so I'm doing great on my journey, by the way. I mean, I've been on my journey, healing journey, since 2007, but I made a lot of progress in 2010, 11, and 12, and even further on. So, I mean, I've done a lot of work on this. I titled this show One Child Abuse Survivor to Another because that's the show that I started doing on Blog Talk Radio a long time ago. You can catch my stuff on Blog Talk Radio if you want to take a listen. I've got a lot of shows there, about 1,000, and I'm actually missing some of my beginning shows because they're not archived anymore. They're just old from like 2009, but 2010 and up to today are there. And you can catch that at www.blogtalkradio.com/Laurie, Laurie hyphen Smith, Smith. And a lot of the shows there are called One Child Abuse Survivor to Another shows, because that was a show that was doing a lot of work on my own healing journey. And I thought it would be helpful for other survivors who may tune in, who are struggling, and just, to know that they're not alone, and that there is help out there, and there's good information out there to help people with coping mechanisms and how to deal with certain things that many survivors may go through. And so that's what I titled the show, One Child Abuse Survivor to Another. So I did a lot of those shows. I don't know how many I did, but I did hundreds, maybe 400 or 500 of those shows. That's a lot of shows. And so I really, I can't even go back and listen to them all. I don't have that much time. And so I appreciate everybody who's tuned into my work. I did have a lot of people following my work on a regular basis. I was doing sometimes, like 2 shows a day. And I would do like a One Child Abuse Survivor to Another show, and then I'd do Child Abuse Prevention show. So I was doing sometimes 2 shows per day. So I ended up with like 1,000 shows, and I did more than that actually, because I did about 400 or 500 with another group. And then I've been on quite a few other shows on Blog Talk Radio, Scan, Stop Child Abuse Now, and sitting on the panel and different places like that, and quite a few different shows. And it was just such a blessing, to be part of that, and really to be a voice out here for people who can't speak up for themselves, who cannot speak out, for whatever reason. Survivors who are really, sort of, on their own. There's a lot of people out there who will not reach out and get help. I know I didn't until the age of like 43. And up until the age of 43, I mean, I really didn't do anything to try to get help from the abuse that I suffered as a child, and I hadn't even dealt with it properly, and never even really did any. I mean, obviously didn't do any healing work, but I knew I had a lot of problems. And so I started methodically working through on One Child Abuse Survivor to Another, and looking at material that I found that's free online and for survivors of abuse. And I really started looking at the issues and, coping mechanisms, and so that I myself could cope. And in the meantime, I really hoped that these shows would help somebody. And that would help somebody else, And then I started a Facebook page, One Child Abuse Survivor to Another. And then I wrote a book. My third book that I wrote, the first book was Life of Death or Redemption, which was really my blog. I started that as a public-facing blog because I wanted my story to be out there, because I really felt that I didn't want to go to my grave and without people knowing the truth of what happened to my family, what happened to my brothers. I was born the seventh child of the last child of seven. And two of my brothers, I mean, killed themselves. And I was heading down that path too. One of my sisters is dead now from cancer. She died at the age of 60, and but she was the oldest, and she's gone now. And then there's another brother. He's still alive. I don't talk to him because we're very dysfunctional. Like the rest of my family, actually cut them off because I just couldn't deal with the same old toxic garbage, because they weren't on a healing journey, and they weren't looking to rest, like to try to bring any kind of restoration to our relationship, which was never really a relationship in the first place. So I want to do this show to talk a little bit about my story, and where I'm coming, where I came from, where I'm coming from, why I guess why I do what I do, to speak out against child abuse. Like it's a huge issue, and it's never, covered enough. There's not enough talk about it. There's not enough done about it, and people say, well, how can we stop people from abusing children? And a lot of it has to do with education, and a lot of it has to do with funding. And it's not so much just going in and picking up the pieces after children are abused. It's really, there needs to be some to prevent children from ever being abused. That's where the money really needs to go. It's a harsh situation out there, And like I was born into abuse. My parents were already abusing each other and the children years before I came along. And I was born out of marital rape, so my mom, I think my sister was too. For a while, I guess I sort of think that she wasn't so much, because my mom did not attack her like she did me, and my mom didn't abuse her the way she did me. My mom always kind of felt sorry for my older sister, who was 5 years older than me, and because she was very sick as a baby. But I was very sick as baby too, and my mom came when I was born. I was actually not really born; it was a C-section because my mom was dying and going into a coma, and they had to take me out because they didn't want me to die, and I was already kind of dying too. We were both poisoning each other with RH, blood factor disease, or whatever you call that. So they did take me out C-section. So I came out December 16th, and so I was supposed to be born in February. So I was a preemie. I was not wanted. My mom, I was a rape child. My dad had raped my mother for years. Had been raping her because she wouldn't have anything to do with him because he was abusing her first of all, and the children, and also because she was told that if she had any more children, she would die. Because after my brother was born, he's 7 years older than me. My mom was told not to have any more children because she could die, and then there was two more born that didn't make it. They were born stillborn in between my brother and me. So within a 7-year period, there was two more children born between one between me and my sister, I think, or both between me and my sister, actually. So within 5 years, my dad had been raping my mother continually, and people just call that, whatever, marital problems. I call it marital rape. And my mom, I mean, she was sick. She was very, very sick physically, but she was also mentally sick, and so was my dad. And they both had so many problems. And so the abuse, I just grew up in this abusive environment. I didn't really know any different. I didn't know that there would be anything different until I started going out and meeting other children and going to their homes and seeing different situations, with other people. And then finally, when I started going to school, which I started early because the social workers actually suggested that I start early, and get out of the house because my parents were brought up on abuse charges and they were hauled into court and they had to meet certain requirements that they were supposed to meet in order to keep the family together, and which they sort of held it together while the social workers were around. But then once the social workers stopped coming around, they didn't attend any of the meetings they were supposed to. They didn't get the kids any help, and my dad was abusing the boys, and so was my mom. But my mom was mainly responsible for my abuse, and my dad was also abusing me. But mainly, my dad's main problem was with his sons because they were trying to protect my mom from him, right? So they were standing up for my mother, and he didn't like that, and he thought that they should be standing up for him or whatever, and he didn't want any lip from them, so he was abusing them. And it was just a stupid, horrible mess. So two of my siblings moved out before I was even born, and the oldest two, and they were 18 and 16 years old when I was born, so they had moved out before I was born. And then I didn't realize they were my siblings until much later. So I just thought I had, a smaller family, and then found out that these other two people were my siblings as well. And they got out, and I mean, they're, we're all so dysfunctional that there was never really any real family situation, you know what I mean? But we did try. I mean, there was a period of time, especially after, especially when I was around 20 or so, where my oldest sister, who would have been 18 years older than me, she was settled, and her and her husband were settled in their life. They were doing really well for themselves, and they used to try to, do family things like, invite us for dinner, invite us for supper. We did that a little bit in my teens too, but it was highly abusive. People would say, was it just discipline? I mean, it's like there's a real big difference between discipline and abuse, and I detailed it all very. Pretty detailed and gory and pretty horrific in A Life of Death or Redemption. That's my first book, and that was like the blog that I was writing. And a friend of mine, actually a lady that I knew who's a best-selling author and a publisher, Donna M. Shear, she suggested that I publish it, and so did another friend of mine who's also an author, and she's a great author, along with Donna. And they don't know each other, but they're two separate sides of the world. But this another friend of mine from years back, when I was a kid, Tammy Baim, suggested that she's an author too, and she suggested that I publish it. And so I said, why not? So the proceeds from that book went to a not-for-profit organization, and I sold quite a few of those books. I was really glad to see that because the money is going to stop and prevent child abuse, so I was happy about that. And then I decided to write another book called La Vita Juvies, and that's detailing my teen years and looking at the abuse that was going on, especially from about 16, 17, right in there somewhere, 15, 16, 17. And the One Child Abuse Survivor to Another, The Journey, that book, I just put that one out last. That one was hard to do. That was detailing the sexual abuse that I suffered as a child. And it's so mind-boggling boggling and mind blowing, you know, because I had to get in touch with those feelings because I had put that so far away from me because I was already struggling, you know, to survive in this abusive home. And I really couldn't even deal with the child sexual abuse. I mean, it was something of itself, you know. I mean, my mother knew about it. I told her what was happening and that my older brother was sexually abusing me. I didn't say those words. I just told her kind of what he was doing. And my mom was like, what do you want me to do about it? It's not my problem, you know. So, I mean, I was just like devastated. I she was already my abuser, so I really didn't push it with her. And I didn't tell my dad because my dad was crazy. And I go into a lot of detail, like in all my other shows, and especially on Blog Talk Radio, One Child Abuse Survivor to Another, and Child Abuse Prevention is Up to Us. That one, those two shows, I actually went into some serious detail, but so, a little bit on Spreaker here too. But the books really detail it out, and I wanted people to know the truth, you know, about what happens to children when they're abused and what they suffer later on as consequences to the abuse, you know. And it's a huge issue for so many millions of people around the world, and just millions in the States alone, let alone Canada and the rest of the world. And I knew so many people who were abused, and I knew, you know, their parents were, some of them abused, and some of their parents were in domestic violence situations. My parents were. And I mean, this was just sort of something that I grew up with. And, you know, it definitely left a mark. It definitely left its mark on me. And it definitely left a bitter taste and a bad taste in my mouth for many years for life. I really wasn't happy and comfortable to be even living for so many years. I always felt that I really didn't belong here and didn't belong anywhere. And that's just because I didn't belong within my own family. And I still don't, you know, so, but I've gotten over that. And I'm so glad, you know, but it took me a long time, and it took me to the brink of suicide, and it took me to the brink of giving up, you know. And that's why I do what I do, because I want to be a voice out here for survivors who are struggling, and they just don't know how they're going to go on. They don't know how they're going to cope. I was there, you know, many times, and many, many times through the years, you know, in my 20s. And actually, by the time I was 10, I was wishing I was dead. And I was wishing that my mom would kill me. I mean, because she was always beating on me severely. And I, you know, like literally spilling my blood and stuff. And I just, you know, I was just like, go ahead and kill me. I'm already dead. You've killed me, you know. I mean, that's how I felt, that my mother had killed me. And in every way. And I was like, all that needs to be done now is just physically put me out of my misery, you know. But I didn't really want to die, you know. And I did a lot of drugs until the age of, from 12 to the age of 21. And then when my brother committed suicide, he was a cokehead. And he's the one that sexually abused me. And he was 13 years older than me. And so when I was 20, he was 33, and he killed himself and committed suicide. He had been trying to commit suicide for years, for many years. And he finally made it. And I was just headed down the same path, and I knew it, because something inside of me was always wanting out, you know. And I was doing a lot of drugs when I was young, especially let's say 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, right in there. So about 5 years of heavy drug use, and I was really not taking care of myself. And I didn't care if I overdosed or not, really. I didn't care if I ended up in the gutter, just overdosed. That was where my life was for quite a few years. And at the age of 20, when my brother killed himself, I realized I was heading that way, and I did want to live. And I was like, no, I want to do this. I want to make it. So I got off the drugs, and I did that myself, you know, but I had to stop hanging around with the people that I was hanging around with, which was my friends who got me through the abuse. And it was a hard situation. They were, many of them, if not all of them, abused themselves. And I'm sure that they felt a little bit, you know, kind of let down, because I told them, I said, man, I've got to get off these drugs because I'm going to die. It's going to kill me. I know it will. And I have to stop. I have to change this, you know. And I don't know if they ever understood exactly the situation, you know what I mean, because they never did get off of them, and many, actually a few of them are dead now, and it's a shame. And so, you know, the consequences are what they are. You know, I knew that if I stayed doing, you know, hanging around with them and doing what I was doing, I was never going to be able to get off the drugs. And so I just totally isolated myself, really, and just worked and didn't party anymore. I just didn't allow myself to party anymore. I was like, no more, you know. I got busy doing other things, and it did help, but I never dealt with the abuse. So at the age of 42, I had been still contemplating suicide for many years, even in my mid-20s, and then later in my 30s. And sitting around on the couch at the age of 42, contemplating suicide again. And I was like, is this ever going to end? Is this pain ever going to end? You know, how am I going to get out of this? This is what abuse does to children. That's why I do what I do. That's why I'm speaking out, because this is what abuse does to children. It's the aftermath, you know, I mean, people don't realize the damage that is done. That's why I speak out. You know, it's very important. It's not a whining, oh, poor me, or, you know, oh, you know, look what they did, or, you know, it's not that. It's to bring awareness to show people what abuse does to people, what damage really happens. You know, like it's incredibly devastating to a person. But I do believe that it's doable to maintain and have a good life after surviving abuse, you know. And people would say, well, what do you do in your life, you know, that helps you to maintain and to get through? And I think it is a struggle, because I'm always second guessing myself. I'm not used to being treated very well by people. So I assume the worst about people all the time. And I always assume that I'm going to be in trouble, because I grew up being just beaten on and beaten on and beaten on for no reason. And so I'm always walking on eggshells, even when I don't need to be, you know. It takes a lot of trust, you know, for me to trust somebody just to be around them, you know. Like, I actually broke up with my husband, who's my husband now, after the first year, because I didn't trust him. I didn't trust anybody. In the first year that we were together, I really discovered that I didn't trust him, and I didn't trust anybody. I didn't trust myself. And it's not that I was afraid he was going to hurt me or hit me, but I was just afraid that I might be not doing the right thing by getting into this relationship. So I took off after a year, because I lost my baby, and then my mother died, and I had left him, and I was on my own, just romping around Vancouver Island and trying to work and make a few bucks. And this was in my 30s. And a year later, it took me a year after my mom died, and after going through some real grieving process of some serious, I never really did deal with the abuse at that time, but I was very much seriously kind of screwed up at that point. But I realized that I missed my husband, who's my husband, Cecil. And I called him, and he said he was just waiting for me to call. He waited a year for me to call. He's awesome, man. He's such a great man. And I mean, we had a good chat, and I mean, I made him sit down, and I told him, he already knew about the abuse, but he didn't know about the real details. And I told him about it all. And I said, you know, we're either going to be here for each other and help each other, or we're not doing this. We're not here to hurt each other. I said, if we're going to hurt each other, let's get out of this right now. If we're going to help each other and be here to help each other and make each other's life good and be here for each other, then let's do it. And he agreed that we would not hurt each other. I agreed that I would not hurt him, and he agreed that he would not hurt me. And we have had 20 awesome, awesome, precious years, you know. And he's terminally ill. He's been terminally ill for 14. And it's like, we still, even through the struggle, we're really best friends and mates and soulmates and partners and in this life, you know. We're a team. And I mean, he's here for me, and I'm here for him, and he loves me, and I love him. And he's not, you know, we've had a few spats in our day, but nothing serious. He's treated me really well. So I mean, I did learn that I could trust some people, you know, through the years. And I've had some really great friends, and I could just name them off, but I mean, I've got some great, great friends, and you know, people who I do have learned that I can trust, you know. But I'm always thinking that, you know, there's something wrong in the relationship. It doesn't matter what kind of relationship it is. So I'm quite often self-sabotaging at work, and self-sabotaging in everything. And it's just from being so, you want to call it battered child syndrome. It is that, but it's also a victim mentality. You know, there's a whole lot of that too, but that's so ingrained in me, you know, from so long ago. It's hard to break, and I've had to work at it. But, you know, what I do is I just try to learn from my mistakes and learn how to deal with things instead of just running, running, running all the time, you know, and sit back and reflect. I do a lot of reflection, and so I don't spend a whole lot of time doing other things, you know, that take up my time. I do spend a whole lot of time in reflection and thinking about how I reacted and what I did, what that person did and how it made me feel, and then what I was feeling coming from my past, from my abuse, you know, from childhood, or is it a true valid feeling from right now as an adult, you know? And a lot of times I have to look back and say, wow, I did that because out of a fear that I was going to be rejected, because I was rejected by my mother and really by my whole family, but my mother is the one who did the damage in that area, you know, and it's, you know, it was a hard thing to be rejected. You know, I mean, it's to have somebody just tell you they hate you, they wish you were dead, you know. And my mom used to tell me that all the time. She'd be like, you should have never been born. I should have killed you when you were in your diapers. And she'd tell me stuff like that. And it wasn't a joke. Like, she was serious. And she'd be like, I should have killed you. I should. And when she was beating on me, she'd be like, I can kill you. It's my right. I can kill you if I want to. You know, you're worthless. Like, she would spit at me. She would spit in my face. Like, I mean, she would beat me horrifically, you know. And it's like, I mean, I loved my mother so much, you know, and I can honestly say that because I'd be lying if I didn't say that. I also hated her, you know. I mean, it was a love-hate thing. I mean, I loved her because I used to try to protect her from my dad. I took beatings from my dad for that, you know, being thrown into walls and slapped around and, you know, beatings with a belt, and because I would try to protect my mother from him. And I kind of thought that should count for something, you know. And it didn't. I found out it didn't count for anything, you know, because my mom, I wasn't worth anything to her. So this is what abused children go through quite often. They're not wanted. That's why they're abused. You know, people say, you know, well, why do people abuse their children? Because they don't consider them to be a human being. They're just an object, right? So for me, my mom, I was just this rape child. I was just an object, something like a punching bag that she could just take her anger out on. You know, as the last kid in the house, 5 years younger than my sister. My sister's already in school. Here, my mom's got this little baby at home. And, you know, this little baby turns 2 and 3. The social workers come around. You know, there's a lot of abuse in the home. Then my mom's pissed because the social workers come around. She got hauled into court with my dad, you know. You know, she wanted to blame it all on my dad. But it was actually both of them that were abusing all of us, right? And this is what abused children go through, you know. And I have to deal with that on a day-to-day basis now. And I mean, I've done really well. I think most people don't realize that I'm a survivor of abuse when they meet me. I don't make it very plain and well known. You know, if they're to meet me, they wouldn't snap. They wouldn't know because I fit in very well with the world. But then when they have dealings with me, they might start to wonder, like, it's a little odd. But, you know, it's just a self-protection. You know, I don't want to be hurt, so I'm going to get out. I don't want to be hurt. That's generally what it is because I don't want to hurt people. So then I just end up leaving jobs, quitting relationships, leaving. That's the name. That's what I do because it's like, well, before you throw me out, I'll leave, right? And I mean, as a child, my mom was throwing me out of the house and telling me I wasn't wanted, and she didn't care if I went into foster care. You know, I kind of fought for her to try to get her to love me, but, you know, it's like, just this whole idea of being the one kid in the family that gets thrown out. I wasn't even the bad kid. I was like the last born and I was a good kid. And my brothers who were walking around threatening to kill my sister with a knife, you know, and robbing us and stealing all of our stuff and stealing the neighbor's stuff and going to jail and ending up in prison and doing drugs in the house and, you know, sexually abusing me and doing all kinds of horrible things. They didn't get thrown out. My parents didn't throw them out. They just beat the shit out of them, but they didn't throw them out. My mom beat the shit out of me and then threw me out, you know? So it's like, I was not wanted, you know? And the rejection, you know, it's harsh. It's harsh to deal with, and it still affects me to this day. But, you know, I just want people to know there is hope out there. There is help. You know, I've made huge progress. I hope you will go listen to my shows, One Child Abuse Survivor to Another, on Blog Talk Radio, because those are full of really great information for people. I learned a lot from doing those shows. It actually helped me a whole lot to do those shows. It was very much a therapeutic thing. It was part of my therapy. And so I'm hoping that people will get something out of those in the future, you know. And it was just my hope to help one person out, you know, who just struggling and having a hard time, because I know there's so many of us out there. And so I would just say, you know, just keep looking for that hope and look for that help, you know, wherever you can find it. Find some trustworthy people, you know, that you can trust, and find, you know, and make sure they are trustworthy, because, you know, you don't want to be re-victimized, right? And get some help. Reach out. Do not give up. Two of my brothers killed themselves. And do not go that route. Do not do it. My brothers lost. They lost big time. My parents murdered them in the first place, soul murder, and then they killed themselves and took themselves out. I was on the same path. And I'm telling you, when I finally decided at the age of 42 that I was going to live and not die, and I was going to make it, it was like, it was victory for me, because I was like, they couldn't kill me. They couldn't kill me. They tried and they didn't succeed. They hurt me, you know, but they couldn't take me out, and they couldn't make me take me out. So, you know what? I just tell you to hold on, And if you're struggling and you're having a hard time, call the crisis line, man. I want to be one of those people on the crisis lines, but I can't do it because my husband's terminally ill and it's too hard to be doing that kind of stuff with this, with what I've got going on right now. But I mean, it would be me, someone like me sitting on the other end, you know, who knows where you've been and really wants to help, right? And they do care. There are some people out there that really do care. So you make sure you reach out and get some help. God bless you all, and we'll talk to you soon. Here's a song by Fragments of a Broken Dream, The Deliverance. The first song was Take a Second by Point Claire. This one is Fragments of a Broken Dream. Take care, everybody. God bless you.